Hello, greetings, Anbol. My name is Strix. I have studied, trained, certified, and worked in several places around the globe as a coach, trainer, consultant, and physician. What we're going to be looking at today centers around perception, but in a strange way, deals with reality itself. Because I don't know if you've ever considered this before, but all we really have of what we call our lives are our memories and our experiences. And both of these are heavily altered by our perception of how things are. By example, each time you access a memory, you are quite literally changing it. Emotional tone and tenor, content of the memory itself, details of the memory. Each time we access a memory, we end up changing it in some way. So much so that a memory you've accessed over and over again tends to be a very different memory from the actual memory that you really had. And the work and research around this actually point out how unreliable witnesses can be. And this is helped to the fact that perception can be so very easily bent. Let's say it in a different way. Perception is all we really have of our reality. And if that is so, and it seems to be that way, and you can take that for testing, if we alter our perception, and if we alter the perception of those around us, our experience and our memories of what we call our reality change. So in a very strange way, because language is so intimately connected to our perception of the world around us and our inner world, with language we're able to bend perception and thus in a strange way bend reality itself. We're able to, with control of attention and focus, alter perception of space, time, energy, and our perception of what truly matters and the weight events and memories carry. We'll be looking at, therefore, how perception affects everything, including our forward performance, meaning how we behave from now. By example, neuro-linguistic programming practitioners have a set of presuppositions from which they come from. These are understandings and the processes and behaviors and skill sets which arise from these understandings, which if they adopt as frames, they tend to behave like exceptionally good hypnotists and hypnotherapists. It's like if you had a very positive way of looking at things, no matter how you looked at things, you always tend to see the useful details, the useful appearances, the useful experiences, the useful memories in whatever you actually experienced during that day. For neuro-linguistic programming and hypnosis and hypnotherapy and conversational hypnotherapy practitioners, they have a set of presuppositions that if you were to start from these presuppositions, you would actually function better, both personally and as someone who helps institute change in others. We will be looking at what we call drivers, or as the master hypnotist Igor Ledachowski calls them, the super drivers, and what these are and how they affect conversational hypnosis is that these drivers are so linked to our identity that they color and filter and mold our perception. Meaning, if, by example, freedom was the thing that was most important to you, you tend to see virtually everything through the contrastive lens of how much freedom is this giving me? Or how much freedom does this thing take? And there are a set of 16 drivers, which more than just being arbitrary core values, are things which are actually definitely true for all humans. It just so happens that we all have a specific rank order sequence for drivers, meaning my set of drivers is arranged and weighted differently from yours. And if we knew what everybody's core drivers were, or at least those people we need to interact with, we would know exactly how to influence, persuade, and help them. And if we knew this before we interacted with people, they would influence the kind of language and the kind of direction we give our language when we interact with these people for whom we know the drivers. We'll be looking at the applications of a hypnotic engagement protocol that you can abbreviate as PACE or PECA, which will include having a purpose for something, getting engaged, calibrating, and adapting along the way. By example, if you were to have somebody who was delivering a talk and he didn't know what his purpose for the talk was, didn't really engage the audience, didn't calibrate to what his audience needed, and didn't really adapt his talk accordingly, you would have a speech and a performance that would fall on heavily deafened ears. We'll be looking at the five pillars of all hypnotic communication that, if you understood, would make you a really powerful communicator once you incorporate them into all of your hypnotic interactions. We'll be looking at the charisma pattern and how to use this in general speech and in communications wherein we hope to influence, persuade, lead, or institute a change. We'll be looking at what I call the charisma embed, which is a way of introducing suggestions and even sometimes strong invisible commands into our communication. We'll be looking at what I call the blitz train, which is like what's commonly termed a yes train, but that can be delivered really quickly and be received more strongly than what people usually call an elevator pitch. A blitz train can be used in regular communications as well as in hypnotherapeutic sessions or even in speaking across a stage or attempting to seal deals. We'll be looking at what I call language or linking language that enables us to both cluster and create beliefs or modify beliefs on the fly, even as we're communicating with our clients or patients. We'll be looking a little bit at mind-bending language, which essentially is a way for unboxing people from the beliefs they've built around themselves or around their perception of reality itself. And what mind-bending language allows us to do is institute a state of suspended judgment that allows for us to rewire and change belief patterns both over time and sometimes right in the moment where we have the hypnotic interaction. We'll be looking a bit at the non-awareness set, which is Master Hypnotist Igor Ledakhovsky's codification of Supermaster Hypnotist Milton Erickson's patterns of engaging and creating change in patients. We'll be looking at stories and how these are not only the greatest carriers of ideas that humanity has ever created, but how we can use these carriers of ideas to carry change for our patients and clients. We'll be looking at what we call patterns of speech that include the quotes pattern, which allows us to embed commands within what looks like a story. We'll be looking at taglines and hang lines and how these create a feeling in our clients and patients like we were somehow echoing inside their minds, and it gives them a feeling that we know exactly what is happening in their minds and that therefore we are the authority in their world. We'll be looking a bit at reframing, which essentially is a, in this case, linguistic way of taking a belief, flipping it around, bending it over, and generally either modifying, shifting, disrupting, or recreating beliefs, so much so that damaging or negative or destructive beliefs become more positive, creative, anti-fragility building, and adaptive beliefs, which help our clients and patients move further forward as productive and functional members of both society and the idea systems that they choose. We'll be looking at how to create commands which seem to be the opposite of commands. We'll be looking at the phenomenon we call priming, that essentially allows us to set the frame before all frames, so much so that on a subconscious level, communication has already started even before we've started to communicate a general idea or direction for our communication with our patients and clients. It's like passing on the idea and feeling of something even before we've begun. It's as if you've run into someone for the first time and you already know what they're going to say. And strangely enough, you prove that to be true. We'll be looking at what we call spins. And what a spin is a state of mind that allows us to not only suspend judgment, but create deep core level change in patients and clients. We'll be looking a bit at what I call invisible hypnotic languaging, which